Good evening, everybody, and good evening, my esteemed panelists. So in this session, we will be discussing the surgical techniques of total laryngectomy. Yeah, so as we all know, the total laryngectomy was first described by Billroth in 1887, and even after 150 years and the era of organ preservation, it remains as equally relevant as it was before. So in the current era, the indications for a total laryngectomy would be locally advanced carcinoma of the larynx, that is with the gross exolaryngeal spread and cartilage destruction, presence of a dysfunctional larynx, that is the patient having aspiration, stridor, or a prior tracheostomy, in cases of post-chemoradiation salvage surgery, where any conservative surgical options are not feasible, non-radiosensitive other histologies, such as salivary gland malignancies, sarcomas, or extensive thyroid cancers, and other patient-related medical factors, such as patients, those are unfit for receiving concurrent chemoradiation, or in a few patients who have a selective preference for surgery over radiation treatment. So as per the previous workup, which has been discussed in the previous session, for posting the patient for a total laryngectomy, along with the prior anesthetic fitness and biochemical tests, one must perform a contrast-enhanced scan of the head and neck and thorax, where we must look for presence of exolaryngeal spread, cartilage destruction, presence of subglottic extension, and metastatic neck nodal disease.
Dr. Vedisha, are we allowed to sort of, you know, interject in the middle, or shall we, will you take questions?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, your comments are very well welcome. But right. I was told that the questions we'll be taking at the end of the session.
Okay. Go ahead. So, Vidish, quite comprehensive as you started off, but you know, one of the primary reasons why we go for cross-sectional imaging before a laryngectomy is to assess operability. Many of the times, you know, these patients have already received chemoradiation, and the recurrences, you know, sometimes do not follow the traditional planes of spread, as we say in cancer. So one of the key areas we would want to see on an imaging is it operable? And the two major issues which we face where, you know, this disease is not operable is when the prevertebral fascia is involved or the carotid sheath is involved. So apart from all the others that you mentioned, probably it will also help us to assess operability by doing a cross-sectional imaging.
Yes, sir. I agree with that. Point well taken. So the next assessment would be performance of a direct laryngoscopy and a biopsy for the confirmation of diagnosis, and a disease mapping by performing a direct laryngoscopy and also for planning the reconstruction during the procedure. Along with these two investigations, when a patient is planned for a total laryngectomy, the patient must be given a preoperative voice rehabilitation counseling, and he has to be explained about various options regarding the voice rehabilitation, such as use of tracheoesophageal prosthesis, electrolarynx, pros and cons of everything. This also will prepare the patient mentally for the major physiological changes that are going to occur after the surgery in the speech and swallowing patterns, as well as breathing. Now, coming to the steps of surgery. These are major steps of the surgery, and they may be performed in a different sequences as per the surgeon preference or as per the individual case. But usually at the start of surgery, we will again perform a direct laryngoscopy and confirm the operability of the disease and possible reconstruction. So after the induction of the anesthesia, patient is in the supine position with a neck extension. For the incision planning, the traditional incision that is described for the laryngectomy is a Glucksurrensis incision, but we also need to take into account various other factors, such as presence of a tracheostomy, previous treatment, such as chemoradiation, which alters the quality of the skin. When there is a previous tracheostomy, whether there is a peristomal skin involvement by the tumor, and are we planning to perform a concurrent neck dissection or reconstruction? So for the traditional Glucksurrensis incision, the landmarks we have to plan are the hyoid bone, the thyroid notch, cricoid cartilage, and the suprasternal notch. In the traditional incision, it is starting from the mastoid tip, curves along gently along the supra-sternocleidomastoid muscle, and meets its counterpart in the midline, just below the level of cricoid cartilage. The proposed site of a tracheostoma is incorporated in the inferior aspect of the flap. We also need to be sure that the planning of the stoma is in the midline to avoid the skewed stoma postoperatively, and make sure that the direction of your incision is towards the mastoid tip and not directed towards the angle of mandible. This picture shows us the various scenarios which we actually face during performance of a tracheostomy, performance of a laryngectomy. This is a traditional glucosurgeon's incision, but when you have a prior tracheostomy, the incision must be modified to incorporate the existing tracheostoma and surrounding unhealthy skin to in the apparent flap incision. Also, when we do not have a prior tracheostomy, one may decide to perform a horizontal skin crease incision with a separate stoma. So I would like to discuss with my other panelists, anybody, what would be the advantage of doing a separate stoma over a traditional glucosurgeon's incision, and in what cases we would prefer this?
Yeah, so has Dr. Elizabeth joined in?
Yes, I am here.
Madam, yeah. So there was a question, is this the standard incision that you use, or do you want to differ from Dr. Vidisha?
Yeah, it is described as a glucosurgeon's incision for a routine laryngectomy procedure. But as she said, it is not routinely done as from mastoid tip to mastoid tip. We can go as it do it as a single transverse incision, two fingerprints above the level of the suprasternal notch, and then to meet the anterior border of the sternomastoid bilaterally. That is one single incision which incorporate the previous tracheostoma. That is one single incision procedure. And as she said, it can be done as a, two incisions. Like you can plan a separate tracheostomy down and another incision above, two fingerprints above that tracheostoma, to plan for your laryngectomy. That will that is more cosmetically acceptable, and also you can prevent, if at all there is a pharyngocutaneous fistula, you can avoid leakage of your saliva into the tracheostoma. So we do both these kind of procedures, like single incision and two incisions, according to the status of the radiated skin of the neck and the previous tracheostoma status, we plan both these procedures.
Yeah, Dr. Vidisha, I agree with Dr. Elizabeth, because when the Glaxorensen devised this incision, chemo radiation had not arrived on the scene.
Yes, sir.
And so most of the time when we do laryngectomies is for salvage. And when you raise a flap with a narrow tail, which actually points to the stoma, and that's a very critical site. If a leak happens at the tail end of it near the stoma, you have more trouble managing it, like keeping a
cover
all the time.
But
so most surgeons have now sort of, you know, graduated into a more horizontal incision, which wouldn't reach up to the mastoid. So that would be my view. So Dr. Asim has anything more to add, or maybe we'll continue.
So preferably what we do is, preferably in a perplanum setting, if we have a, we try to take a horizontal skin crease incision in most of the cases, if possible. So an option of a separate stoma is always there, but we have to also consider the length of the neck when we are doing so.
I agree with that. Yeah.
So when we have a short neck or a chubby patient, then we may not be able to take a separate incision or a horizontal skin crease incision.
Right.
However, and in a long neck, this gives an option of a separate stoma.
And a horizontal incision. Yeah. Because if you don't leave a sufficient bridge between the incision and the stomal site, that little
the skin
bridge
may get necrosed. And especially in the post chemo radiation setting, it would be a dicey thing to have a narrow skin bridge between the stoma and an incision.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank so you. After we have planned our incision with prior discussion, and as it was discussed in the case presentation, if you have a extensive peristomal skin involvement or the skin involvement by tumor, you need to incorporate it in the incision at this stage itself and plan your reconstruction, whether by a rotation skin flap or dentopectoral or PMMC flap, whatever is your choice. So after the after the incision planning, the flaps are raised in the conventional fashion subplatysmally, superiorly till the level of hyoid and the submandibular glands, and a planned neck dissection is performed. Usually in a node positive neck, we would perform neck dissection 2 to 5, and in an N0 neck, we would do a 2 to 4 neck dissection. If I may discuss here, in which cases we would perform a unilateral versus a bilateral neck dissection. Asim, can you just tell us what would be your philosophy about this? What subsites, and when will you go unilateral versus bilateral neck dissection?
So in all cases of a laryngectomy that we do, we would prefer doing a level 2 to 4 bilateral neck dissection in a N0 neck. In a N+ neck, I would consider doing a level 2 to 5 neck dissection in the site of the disease.
Yeah, so if I may add, in the supraglottic subside and a hypopharyngeal subside, we may want to do a bilateral neck dissection, even if it is a N0 case. While it's in a lateralized glottic disease, you may just do a unilateral neck dissection.
So, Dr. Vidisha, if I may add, this has been a subject of debate for so long, because again, the change in the demographics of the patient you receive, most of them would be coming for salvage. And the neck would already have been treated with chemo radiation. It's not easy to go into a chemo radiated neck. And that's primarily the reason we ball cut it. I mean, so we just
move. Yes, this discussion pertains to a paraprimum.
The second issue is that complications are also higher. Whatever the journals may say, whatever the studies may say, if you ask anyone, you know, you would always be happy with a paraprimum neck than a radiation. So there were a lot of papers, 2009 laryngoscope, this was Eben Rosenthal, said that don't do a neck. There's only about a 4% positivity in the neck. So hardly any point giving more complications. And definitely there were higher complications in his series, but only about 40 patients. No difference in survival, but there was a trend towards worsening disease-free survival. That means, you know, patient failed in the neck. At least there was a trend, which he was not able to demonstrate with his 37 patients. There were a few systematic reviews which came after that. And there was one by Lin in 2019. This is from Columbus, Ohio. This was a systematic review, more patients, higher level of evidence. Again, I'll echo your words, Vidisha, that what this thought was, you know, more about 20% of the patients had nodes, even with an N0 neck prior or on imaging at the time of before surgery or preoperative workup. A 20% chance of nodal metastasis if the recurrence was in the supraglottis. So the supraglottic site is a red herring. It tells you that maybe there are nodes present. More recently, 2020, last year, there was this Jennifer Gross meta-analysis, which again came out. Again said the occult node rate was about 10%. But survival was not very different. So we still don't know about local control in these patients when we don't do neck dissection. There's another thought which goes on, why don't you do a PET scan, just like you have the PET neck study. And if the PET is positive, you go ahead and do the neck, otherwise you leave it. But
yes, sir, but to counteract this, it won't be effective for occult nodal metastasis. PET scan would not be good for occult nodal metastasis.
And you are
it helps in a salvage situation, but not in a paraprimum.
What is the evidence for that? There's a paper by Roscoe says that the negative predictive value of a PET in a salvage larynx is only about 70%. So exactly what you said, Dr. Vidisha. So that is the literature to support.
So now coming after performing the neck dissection, let's go on to the steps of a laryngectomy. So the first step while performing a laryngectomy would be the skeletonization of the larynx. Various infra and suprahyoid strap muscles are attached at the hyoid and which facilitate movements of the larynx. While doing the skeletonization in the infrahyoid region, we will come across the anterior jugular veins which need to be ligated and the infrahyoid strap muscles, namely the omohyoid and sternothyroid and sternohyoid, need to be cut close to their sternal attachments. When coming at the suprahyoid region, one must be very conversant with the anatomy of lingual artery, which passes immediately medial to the hyoglossus muscle in the region of the greater cornea of hyoid. And while we are skeletonizing these muscles, that is myelohyoid, geniohyoid, stylohyoid, one must be very careful to stay close to the greater cornea of the hyoid to avoid the damage to these important structures of a loop of lingual artery and the hypoglossal nerve. In this picture collage, we can see the sequential skeletonization of the suprahyoid larynx, that is the hyoid bone in the midline. Here you can see the lesser and greater cornea coming into the picture. Next, you are grabbing the greater cornea of the hyoid with the Allis forceps or a cricoid hook and staying absolutely close to the bone, you are skeletonizing the entire cornea of the hyoid bilaterally. So the next step after the skeletonization we want to discuss is the management of the thyroid gland. As it has been previously discussed, the thyroid gland will be situated anteriorly over the second to fourth tracheal rings, and it can be involved by the disease process by direct exolaryngeal spread due to either cricothyroid membrane or a gross destruction of the thyroid cartilage. While on the imaging, we must note the exolaryngeal spread, presence of subglottic disease, anterior commissure involvement, and the involvement of the piriform apex. So my next question to all of our panelists is, when do we decide whether we are doing a hemithyroidectomy versus a total thyroidectomy for these patients?
So may I answer?
Or, yes,
Dr. Asim,
yes,
you want to put
in? Please go ahead.
Okay, so again, the issue of thyroid invasion, right? So the reason why you take out the thyroid is because you suspect that the disease from the larynx might have gone into the thyroid. And if you leave it there, you might compromise on disease clearance. So there have been, I think, two systematic reviews and meta-analysis, one from Europe and one from North America. So the Europe one comes from Vinit Paleri's group again. Somewhere in 500-600 patients around 2014. And from all the papers that they got together, around 1,180 patients. And they realized that the invasion, the rate of the invasion was around 11%. So only about 10% of the patients whom you really remove a thyroid have disease inside the thyroid. And the primary subside, which is the subglottic, if the disease is extending into the subglottic or disease has its localization, has its nidus in the subglottic, these are more prone for thyroid cartilage invasion. It was presumed that a hypopharyngeal tumor goes into the thyroid more than the thyroid, but this systematic review failed to reveal that. So the one from North America is by Mendelson. She's from Quebec. And this again had around 400 patients. So again, in her meta-analysis as well, we found that it is the subglottic site. The disease going into the subglottis has a higher chance of going into the thyroid. Again, she did not find any relation to the piriform fossa site or cartilage invasion. But however, in 2014, you know, Dr. Koh of robotic thyroidectomy fame, Dr. Koh's studies showed in about 60 patients with thyroid, so that if thyroid cartilage is involved, so most likely that the thyroid gland would be involved. So if, to sum up, maybe thyroid gland invasion, presence of a subglottic tumor, some papers do, even though they are not in the systematic analysis, the presence of a hypopharyngeal primer would decide whether you want to take out the thyroid node. Ipsilateral or bilateral is another issue which has not been resolved in literature yet. But yes, I would presume that if the disease is localized to one side, if it's an ipsilateral tumor, you would remove the tumor from that side.
Yeah, so if I may say,
postgraduate teaching, I would like to urge, like in a case when we are going at for a total laryngectomy, in an ipsilateral site, when there is a supraglottic or subglottic disease, we will do a hemithyroidectomy on the ipsilateral side. If we have a gross invasion of the thyroid gland involved, or the gland is directly involved due to extra thyroid extension, I would go urge for doing a total thyroidectomy in such a case. And in a bilateral disease, I would consider doing a total thyroidectomy.
Yeah.
So
okay.
For the postgraduate teaching and for the purpose, we would say ipsilateral thyroidectomy, hemithyroidectomy in an ipsilateral disease. For a bilateral disease, total thyroidectomy, and a gross invasion of thyroid disease, go ahead for a total thyroidectomy.
Yeah, I agree with you, Singh. So now coming to the next step.
Vidisha, shall I add something?
Yes, ma'am, please.
Yeah, previously we were doing a ipsilateral hemithyroidectomy in all cases of laryngectomy because suspecting subglottic spread, and that was the routine teaching. But we have done a study on all our thyroids removed along with the laryngectomy specimen, and we have found about around 20 to 22% of thyroid gland pathological involvement by the tumor in a laryngectomy specimen. And the statistically significant factors were like a preoperative radiological involvement of the thyroid gland, or a perioperative like a post-cricoid growth, and a circumferential tumor in the subglottic area. So nowadays, actually, for the last few years, we have started doing only the isthmusectomy along with the laryngectomy, and we are not finding any problem tumor involvement in the residual thyroid gland, which is retained back. And that too, as the previous panelist was describing, like in a high volume disease with extra laryngeal spread and the soft tissue involvement, maybe you can go for a total thyroidectomy. Otherwise, if it is a minimal cartilage involvement at the side of the anterior commissure, maybe you can even confined to an isthmusectomy and preserve both lobes. That's what our data is showing.
Yeah, I think we need to look at our final histopathology. You will be surprised to see that very few of our thyroid glands are actually infiltrated by disease. Don't just go by the book. Do an audit. Find out from your ear. You will be surprised to see how many thyroids we just conk away without reason. There is an argument saying that, oh, these patients have received chemo RT, 50% of them would be hypothyroid. So don't worry, just chop it off. But even then, you know, there is a luminal, a basal level of hormones which are secreted by this hormone, which you only need to augment with an additional...
Yeah, the amount of supplementation changes.
Yes. So in times of stress, it's your native thyroid which you take care of, not the tablet.
So after performing the skeletonization in the laryngectomy, we come to the next step of devascularization. As we all know, the larynx and the upper trachea are supplied from the branches of superior and inferior thyroid arteries. And when we encounter the laryngectomy, the vessels that we are going to come across are superior laryngeal pedicle at thyroid membrane, the superior thyroid artery and vein at the superior pole, the middle thyroid vein, and the inferior thyroid artery and its branches. So as discussed previously, if we are not planning to preserve the thyroid lobe on that side, we may ligate all the vessels, that is superior laryngeal, superior thyroid, and inferior thyroid artery, as well as the middle thyroid vein. But if you are bent the side, you are planning to preserve the thyroid lobe, one must preserve the blood supply and the venous drainage of the thyroid gland and ligate only the superior laryngeal pedicle on that side. And most importantly, if at all we are doing a total thyroidectomy, one must take all precautions to preserve the blood supply to the parathyroid glands to prevent the postoperative dreaded complication of hypocalcemia here. So after the skeletonization and the devascularization larynx, we come to the step of detaching the pharyngeal constrictor muscles. Here at the thyroid cartilage, the three muscles are namely attached, that is sternothyroid, the thyrohyoid, and the inferior constrictor of the pharynx. These constrictor excision depends on to your extent of the disease in the piriform fossa. The cutting of these constrictors is performed prior when the disease is only endolaryngeal. While if you have disease present in the piriform fossa, you may want to cut this pharyngeal constrictor along with the mucosal cuts to ensure that you have an adequate soft tissue margin. When you are cutting this pharyngeal constrictor, we also skeletonize the superior cornea of the thyroid cartilage. Here, we need to take care that we don't enter into the piriform mucosa and don't elevate it excessively so that we don't have a lot of unsupported mucosa later on while completing the pharyngeal closure. So the next important step in the step of laryngectomy will be of airway transfer. Herein, we will detach the larynx from the trachea and continue ventilation through a flexometallic tube inserted directly into the trachea. So at the start of this step, we must alert our anesthesia colleague, make sure that you have appropriately sized flexometallic tubes available, have their cuff checked, and appropriate circuit present to connect it to the anesthesia machine. Here, one important point we need to remember that these tracheal rings are connected to each other with the trachealis muscles. And level of tracheal cut is traditionally, when you don't have a laryngectomy, can be done between the second and third cartilaginous ring. So as the traditional teaching goes, one must make the cut on the trachea at the inferior border of the superior tracheal ring so as to preserve all these trachealis muscle. Avoid the direct exposure of the cartilage, which may lead to a potential chondronecrosis. Again, to reiterate the points we discussed in the case presentation, we must not do a low tracheostomy, because when you have a prior tracheostomy, the tracheal cut goes one ring below the level of tracheostomy. So if you have a low tracheostomy, you will have to cut it further below and then you will end up with a very low stoma. So this care must be taken while performing a tracheostomy for potential laryngectomy, that you do a high tracheostomy at the first or second tracheal rings. So in this case, we can see this picture shows us the location of our potential tracheal cut. We must instruct the anesthetist that they have to deflate the cuff of our endotracheal tube. We make the incision into the tracheal cartilage with the 11 number knife blade. This incision is carried forward all through the tracheal ring, and then this cut is joined along the membranous trachea to complete the airway transfer. At this point, we insert the flexometallic tube directly into the trachea, inflate the cuff, and confirm the bilateral lung ventilation. We may accidentally insert the tube too much inside and result in a single lung ventilation. So we must be very careful regarding this point here. So after we have performed airway transfer and the skeletonization of the larynx, next step is to do a laryngeal entry. In this step, we must be aware of the spread of the disease into the pre-epiglottic space as well as the supraglottic larynx involving the AE folds and disease coming to the pharyngoepiglottic fold. In this step, we enter the valicula in the midline. We first identify the median glossoepiglottic fold and the valicular mucosa. The next, when the epiglottis starts coming into the picture, we grab it with a blunt instrument and then we make the laryngeal entry. So the laryngeal entry, we usually make on the side to opposite of the disease so as to we are not close to the disease side and we preserve the adequate amount of mucosa. When you have done the laryngeal entry, make sure that you inspect the disease visually again, see the extent and then proceed with your mucosal cuts to circumscribe the disease. For the step of circumscribe the disease, as my personal preference, I prefer to do this step from the head end so that you have a complete visualization of your tumor end on. You can see the tumor and the endolarynx and the pyriform and then you take your cuts under vision. So while circumscribing disease in this picture, it is a completely endolaryngeal disease. So you may preserve a good amount of a pyriform mucosa. So you should continue your cuts along the AE fold and into the pyriform mucosa. Sequentially, these cuts are turned into a horizontal direction in the retroarytenoid region over the cricoid cartilage and joined together. So after we have completed the circumscribing of the disease, the next important thing is to know the right avascular plane of the party wall for the separation of the larynx from the cricopharynx. In this step, we usually ask our assistant to retract the cricopharynx towards his side and we find an avascular plane between the trachea and the cricopharynx. And while developing this avascular plane, we can easily separate the entire specimen, which is out for inspection. So once you have removed your specimen, you must examine your specimen carefully for any close margin. For the presence of subglottic disease, your margin on the tracheal cut. And if you may want, you may send the specimen for a frozen section analysis if you're not sure of any of the margins.
Dr. Vidisha, may I interject here? You know, the point of entry is very classical. You said it's from the pyriform fossa. You go suprahyoid, you grasp the epiglottis and do it. So I want to know, panelists, can you just share, is this always the way you do it? What if there is a supraglottic tumor going on to the epiglottis, going on to the pre-epiglottic space? Would you prefer the same entry or would you prefer a more lateral entry through one of the valiculae?
Yes, sir. As I said, you can do it from the opposite side of the right. disease, not exactly in the midline, so that you're right. not close to the disease.
You may even go lateral. You open into yes. the pharynx and assess if it's a base of tongue, it's going into the pre-epiglottic space. So that's perfect.
Yes, Arun, the routine way of entry for us is usually the upper pharyngotomy, like in the near the base tongue area. We usually yeah. enter. That's always easy for
the
us.
Standard way. I agree with you, ma'am.
It is a supraglottic disease and extending to the base tongue, maybe yeah. on the contralateral side, you can enter and yeah. enter the pharynx.
So the message is don't cut through tumor.
Yeah.
Don't cut through tumor. If you see there is tumor, okay. go away from it and open.
Okay.
And one point encompass it completely during your resection.
The you. Point since we have the picture on right now, the specimen where you have inked the margin. So we have to be very careful when we are in a disease where the medial wall of the pyriform fossa or the posterior AE fold is involved. In such disease, we have to be very careful while taking the soft tissue margin because these soft tissue margins may be very close when we are taking the or trying to save a lot of mucosa in this area.
Right.
So after the delivery of the specimen, our next steps are maturation of the end laryngostoma. So here, as we have planned previously, it could be a separate stoma or it could be a stoma that has been incorporated in the inferior part of the incision. The important points that we need to remember while doing this step is first, we need to cut the medial ends of the bilateral sternocleidomastoid muscles so as to avoid the future stromal stenosis laterally. The second thing is that you have to remove all the excessive fibrofatty tissue in the same area so that your skin of the stoma is well opposed to the tracheostomy. And then we perform half matrix sutures to approximate the tracheal cartilages to the skin incision we have made. Also, we need to remember here that we have to stretch the posterior membrane stoma tightly so that we get a nicely D-shaped stoma. So any inputs from anybody as to what will be considered as an adequate stoma or any other special precautions you need to take while maturing the stoma for these cases?
So in patients in which the trachea is very narrow, like around 8 to 10 millimeters, or especially in female patients when you're doing a laryngectomy and maturing the stoma, in such cases, at times we prefer cutting the two rings of the trachea laterally in both the sides and feeding the extra skin and getting a wide stoma in the during intraoperatively itself, rather than having a short stoma and making a stoma of around 8 to 10 millimeter at that time. Other than that, all the precautions that you mentioned about the tenotomy and the maturing the stoma, clearing the fibrofatty tissue, it should follow all those precautions.
Yeah, and roughly what we have been discussing is that the size of the stoma should be equal to the size of the thumb of the patient so that the patient is able to occlude the stoma well if we are planning to use a tracheoesophageal prosthesis for voicing in future.
Yeah, size of the stoma should be of the left index finger of the patient, and also the size should be approximately like an oval shape rather than a circular stoma. Circular stomas are usually more prone for stenotic stoma, so that's why we cut the trachea in a beveled fashion in a C-shaped or a fish mouth pattern, and always cut the sternal heads of the sternomastoid.
Yes, yes.
See,
gland is bulky, and when the thyroid gland is too bulky, and we in those times we need to rotate the thyroid gland and fix laterally so that that does not cause obstruction and cause stenosis of the stoma.
If there was a formula which could give me a good stoma in all patients, I would have followed it. Honestly, I don't have one. Even though I try all kinds of techniques to do, I think it's a dynamics of wound healing at the stoma which finally decides what size of the stoma the patient would eventually have. He would have a lovely stoma to come out with. Come back after 6 months, he would have shrunken to the size of a pinhole. And after having taken all the precautions of fish mouth or a dolphin's mouth or whatever I did, the only little precaution that I take is sometimes I feel, I don't know, this is just that it's cartilage exposed, which gives rise to granulations. And Dr. Vidisha said, if she tries the half mattress, the goal of it is to bury the cartilage. The cartilage is avascular, tends to necrose very quickly with bacterial infection, probably promotes granulation and healing with fibrosis.
Yes, sir. And if you had a fistula post-op which tracked into the tripointer, if you had a suture breakdown, that is also one factor which could contribute to later stomal stenosis.
Yeah, and this fish mouthing actually helps if you're putting in a TEP. You know, it'll help the patient to occlude it with his thumb. So these are the only two sort of guidelines that I follow when I do a stoma. And I realize the size of the trachea is also very different in different people. Some people have very small trachea. You can't have a huge stoma with a person with a small trachea. There's no way you're going to increase it in any way. And there are patients with these huge tracheas which come back with stenosis at a later
But sir, do you routinely perform a stomaplasty if you had a very narrow trachea, as Dr.
Ruskin? That is on follow-up. And I would sort of talk to the patient, find out if he's having difficulty. The biggest problem with a small stoma is crusting and obstruction. And if he's having crusting and obstruction very frequently, sometimes they do come to the emergency with a blocked stoma, especially if they're not on any kind of a
laryngeal valve or a tracheostomy. Yeah, and also they would find it difficult to care for the TE prosthesis as well.
Exactly. So in such situations, my threshold for doing a stomaplasty will be lower.
Yeah. Yeah. So the next important step we need to do while performing all the laryngectomy is the cricopharyngeal myotomy. So as we all know, the inferior constrictor is a circular muscle and it forms the upper esophageal sphincter. So in this step, we incise this muscle longitudinally to reduce the possibility of a hypertonic segment postoperatively. In this, usually we insert a finger in the cricopharynx, stabilize the mucosa, and with a one single sharp cut, this cricopharyngeal muscle is incised till you get your submucosal vessels exposed. Be careful not to deepen this incision excessively, or you will end up having a through and through defect into the mucosa. So any insight as to how long your length of your cricopharyngeal myotomy would be, or which site, whether a median or lateral, would make any difference in this situation?
Yes, I put usually the midline one, and sometimes I put lateral also, the myotomies, and the inferior extent usually I go up to the cuttage of the tracheal wall.
Yeah, right. So I would say that you should go till the end of the TE puncture site so as to get a nice wide lax cricopharyngeal sphincter. And I don't think it makes any much difference whether if it is a medial or a lateral cricopharyngeal myotomy. Please, I beg to for any opinions if there is any difference from anybody.
I might prefer a medial midline this one, cricopharyngeal myotomy, and the same as mentioned till the lower end of the cartilage.
Yeah, and after the performance of the myotomy, we have to insert a finger in the cricopharynx to make sure that there is a feeling of a giveaway and the sphincter is lax to ensure that we have performed the adequate myotomy at this point of time. And let me be add one more point. This cricopharyngeal myotomy should be performed whether we are planning to insert a primary TP or we are planning to do it as a secondary procedure, because we cannot go back when you are planning a secondary TP and go perform a cricopharyngeal myotomy at that point of time. So whether you are inserting TP at this point of time or not, it's better to perform the myotomy in this primary setting. So now coming to the another important aspect of the surgery of a laryngectomy, the tracheoesophageal voice prosthesis. As we have discussed, it can be a primary prosthesis insertion at the time of laryngectomy, or we may want to defer this procedure as a secondary procedure after maybe completion of our adjuvant treatment. So what is our panel's take on whether we should choose primary or secondary, in what cases, what would be our absolute contraindication for performing the primary TP during laryngectomy?
So in a salvage setting, if it's a badly radiated neck and the tissues are not really healthy, we may defer it as a secondary TEP. We may not do a primary TEP, anticipating a peritonitis fistula, and it's difficult to manage a prosthesis during a leak. So if according to the tissue status, we plan for a primary, and definitely we have to motivate the patient, the anatomical status, all the selection criteria for a TEP has to be done before surgery itself.
Yeah, and one more point, if I add, if the stoma is your, if it is a very low tracheal cut, you have a low-lying stoma, then you may want to defer a primary TP insertion, because your TP will be further in the depth and caring for such TP may not be feasible in the postoperative period. Yes. And in cases where you have a separation of a tracheoesophageal party wall, in cases such as a gastric pull-up surgery, yeah, it is advisable not to perform a primary TE puncture, because the integrity of the party wall, which is most important, is compromised in this case.
All right. Agree with you. Also, and even when you put in flaps, and I would be hesitant to put in a primary.
Yeah.
Also, in patients where we are doing a free jejunal flap, even when the party wall is intact, in such cases also at times you consider delaying a primary TP or not doing a TP in such case at all.
So I may beg to differ in this point. We may perform primary TEP in the cases we are doing a circumferential section and a free jejunum. But literature says that voice quality with the free jejunum is not as good, because it results in a gurgly and wet secretions because of the secreting jejunal mucosa. So the quality of voice is inferior to that of a fasciocutaneous flap is what the literature reports in these cases. So now coming briefly to the steps of the TEP insertion. With over time, there has been quite a good development in the various prosthesis patterns. Initially, there used to be Provox 1, then it came to be Provox 2, and now we have a Vega voice smart inserter system. But essential steps of the insertion of a TEP remain same no matter what procedure you are using. So the equipment that you get along in this Vega voice prosthesis system is a pharyngeal protector. This is a troca, a guide wire to guide your reload your prosthesis onto it, an inserter, and the actual TE prosthesis. So coming to the steps of insertion of the TE prosthesis, one must be sure that the integrity of the tracheoesophageal party wall is well maintained. Then we insert the pharyngeal protector in the cricopharyngeal lumen. Herein we have to mark the site of insertion of the TEP. Usually it will be about 8 to 9 millimeters from the edge of the membranous trachea, wherein you insert the troca. Over this troca, a guide wire is then threaded. Here we can see a guide wire that has been threaded over the troca. After threading of the guide wire, we then remove the pharyngeal protector and the troca, and then the smart inserter with the loaded prosthesis is inserted on it. In this step, we can see the TE prosthesis that has been brought out with the help of the inserter. and then we cut the silicon attachment that comes with the TE prosthesis loading, rotate your prosthesis to a normal position with the tip of the prosthesis lying at 6 o'clock. One must ensure that the esophageal flange of your prosthesis is in the cricopharyngeal lumen and not lying in the party wall by putting your finger in the cricopharynx, and make sure that your prosthesis is rotating all along well 360 degree. That means it is in a good position. Okay, these are the steps that you need to perform while performing a tracheoesophageal prosthesis insertion. So any other points that I have missed during
this? Disha, one of the, I think somebody had asked regarding the size of the TP for...
Yeah.
So we usually use a 8 millimeter TP in most of the primary TP insertions, because that is the size of the tracheoesophageal party wall in most of the cases.
You can actually measure it, Dr. Azim. So the Provox group actually gives you a set. There's a flexible flange which goes in, and you can slide a rule over or a graduated ruler, which will give you the size of the size.
So usually they provide with a sizer also. You can
when we do a primary TP, we can size it and measure it. But in the taking a universal size, that we also have a study from TMH regarding the same, where we use a 6 to 8 millimeter size, and that is the most commonly fitting all.
Right. Another point is what width it is, whether it is 22 French or whether it is some other size. Because when we are inserting the TEP and when we have a radiation later on, sometimes we have a peri-TEP leakage. So then it is the condition where your TEP is, the T puncture is dilated and you have a periprosthetic leakage. So there is one point to consider whether we want to put a size bigger than 22.5 French or some other size should be used. So that another consideration also be taken into account.
But how can you prevent it, Dr. Vidisha? How do you know there's going to be pistoning?
I don't think so. There is any reliable way right now for us to predict it. But that's just one another consideration that has been coming into the literature, that what is the width of the TP that you are putting in situ.
Right. It's called pistoning. If you put a longer one.
Pistoning. Yes.
Yeah. Always, as Dr. Azim said, 6 to 8 millimeter, the shorter length is always good to prevent the leak. And as you said, if there is a periprosthetic leak and if you can't control it with a purse string suturing or surrounding that TEP, maybe there are large esophageal flange prostheses are also available.
Yes.
Larger flanges. Leakage, yes. Yeah. That you can use.
Yes. Yeah. So after we have inserted the TP, now we come to the golden question of pharyngeal closure. This is probably the most talked about step in a laryngectomy, because the pharyngeal closure is an important step and that can lead to the complications such as pharyngocutaneous fistula. So coming to the discussion again, that when you discuss to the primary closure versus augmentation of a pharyngeal mucosa while performing a laryngectomy, what would be the cutoff length of the pharyngeal mucosa, or what other factors would we take into account while taking this decision?
To consider the primary closure of the pharyngeal mucosa, if it's a per-primum patient without any prior radiotherapy or chemotherapy, the mucosa is pliable and healthy. So I would consider 2.5 centimeter as a length of the remnant mucosa adequate to do a primary closure. If the patient is radiated, with the mucosa very bad, thick, non-stretchable mucosa, in such cases, I may consider doing the primary closure only when we have a more than 3.5 centimeter or more of length of the mucosa as a remnant mucosa.
So always it is different for primary and salvage setting. As you said, in primary setting, it should be around, like if one piriform sinus is resected, maybe you can close it primarily. But if it's more than a 1.5 PFS mucosa, maybe you have to consider that size around 2.5 centimeter in an unstretched mucosa of unstretched. But in a salvage setting, if it's not a healthy mucosa and if the mucosa is not pliable, it's always better to augment with a patch, pectoralis major or other fascia cutaneous plaque.
Yeah, I may agree that in the salvage setting, we may have a lower threshold to do a pharyngeal augmentation as opposed to a per-primum setting when we know the quality of a pharyngeal mucosa is already compromised because of prior radiation. We may have a lower threshold to augment this pharyngeal mucosa. Again, I agree with that point. So in the literature, as we know, various types of the closure have been described, such as Y-shaped closure, T-shaped closure, vertical or horizontal closure. It has been there has been no conclusive proof of any technique being better over the other, but it is generally accepted that a T type closure with an inherent weak tripointer should be avoided, which may lead to higher chances of developing a pharyngocutaneous fistulas. So there are certain articles that they have said that a vertical pharyngeal closure may lead to formation of a pseudovalicula in future, and they may contribute to the more dysphagia and poor voicing as compared to the horizontal closures. So some authors prefer horizontal closure over a vertical closure, but obviously this is an anatomical decision whether your mucosa is approximating well in a vertical fashion or in a horizontal fashion. Similarly, various type of suturing techniques such as continuous interlocking, extramucosal, Lambert, Connell, Gambia have been described, and all have their advantages or disadvantages. But in literature, no single technique has been shown to be better or inferior for development of pharyngocutaneous fistulas. So to say that adequate amount of a vascularized friable mucosa, approximation without tension, and avoidance of hematomas at the mucosal edges are of utmost importance while doing a pharyngeal closure, whatever may be your technique of choice, whether it is continuous, interrupted, whatever is your preference and comfort, you may choose. After the first layer completion of the pharyngeal closure, the remnant amount of constrictor may be sutured over as a second layer buttressing over the suture, and then the pharyngeal closure will be completed. Any other thoughts regarding optimizing the pharyngeal closure, or any tips to reduce the chances of pharyngocutaneous fistula while closing the pharynx?
Tension-free closure.
Yes.
As you said, the suture material or the technique of closure doesn't significantly affect the rate of leak, but always it is a tension-free suture. And the 3 points junction should be avoided. As you said, a T-shaped closure should be avoided. Either it's a vertical, or if you have enough mucosa for closure, it should be a horizontal suturing so that it gives better swallowing and better speech.
Yes. Yeah. So recently, just to add, a few authors in the West have described about the stapler closure of the horizontal defects, and they have said that the leak rates are better over manual suturing due to avoidance of the technical errors due to manual suturing defects. But again, this evidence is not a very strong evidence. There are very few papers which have said that the stapler closure is better than the routine manual closure.
There is one from Dr. Elizabeth's Institute as well.
Yes, ma'am. What do you say about the use of staplers for closing the pharynx, ma'am?
Yeah, we do stapler closure only if the lesion is purely intralaryngeal and there is no skipping into the piriform sinuses. So that is one prerequisite for applying stapler. And also in salvage setting, sometimes you have to look meticulously whether the pharynx is easy to mobilize from the laryngeal skeleton. So if you can mobilize and skeletonize the larynx and separate the laryngeal skeleton away from the pharyngeal mucosa, or if you have a real pliable mucosa, you can apply the stapler in between. Otherwise, if there is so much of adhesion or less pliability, maybe it's better to cut off the tumor and then do it hand-sewn suture. And then the leak rate, as Arun was saying, we have found that less leak rates along with our stapler closure. But when you apply stapler, a chance of stricture formation is relatively more for a stapler closure. That's what, even though it is not statistically significant, in our data, it is more chance of a stricture in a stapler closure. And in stapler closure, we have found usually the leak will be real. If at all there is a leak, it will be really minimal. And there will be at the central part of the neck, a minimal pinpoint leak will be there that can be conservatively managed.
So in TMH recently, we specifically, Dr. Pai, have started using a barbed wire suture, that is a strata fix, for doing the pharyngeal mucosal closure. And we have found initial encouraging results. I guess Dr. Pai is also conducting a study over the success rate of use of barbed sutures in pharyngeal closure. Is Pai sir around to tell us about that? Yeah, so is you.
So, Vidisha, I think it is too early to comment on the different suture materials and especially Stratafix. Yeah. What we would suggest is, as Arun and Elizabeth and Asim rightly pointed out, you have to have tension-free closure. you need to evaluate the pharyngeal mucosal quality before you plan your closure. See that it is of adequate length, and if whenever you have a doubt, please augment it.
Yes, I do. Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Yeah, so this is another paper from our institute, which was done at a prospectively looking at various factors contributing to the pharyngocutaneous fistula. Again, this paper says that the type of closure, layer of closures, various type of sutures, materials did not make any difference in the incidence of pharyngocutaneous fistulas, but previous chemoradiation and the tumors present in the piriform sinuses led to more leakage rate. Again, saying the same thing as to the what type of suture and closure does not really affect the chance of your forming of pharyngocutaneous fistulas. So again, the next situation, when we do not have a sufficient pharyngeal mucosa, as in tumors of the piriform sinus, definitely we need to augment these pharyngeal mucosas. Here again, we have to see the amount of residual pharyngeal mucosa. What we usually do is we measure the pharyngeal mucosal length at three sites, at the base tongue and the middle and the cricopharyngeal sphincter, and then we decide among the size of the flap that we want to augment it with. Any thoughts about whether a PMMC or a free flap would be better for pharyngeal augmentation, and what would be the advantage of one over the other?
So whenever feasible in such a defect, consider doing a free ALT flap, because definitely it will give a good support. There would not be any pull, and it will be better off. But as of comparing which will be better in results, I would prefer
in terms of leak rate and your swallowing and speech outcomes, both things we have to look into.
So the swallowing outcomes will definitely be better with a free ALT in such a case. And leak rates are not going to make much of a difference whether it's a PMMC or a ALT.
Okay. Or any other difference of opinion?
Yeah, I have limited experience with pre-flap reconstruction in these cases, but we routinely use spectralis major or a supraclavicular flap or a deltopectoral flap. And even for a skin defect and the pharyngeal defect, we use the folded spectralis major flap for the inner lining and for the cover. So the leak rate may not change even after your reconstruction with some flaps, but it can contain the leak, and the leak will heal faster if you put a flap. That's our experience.
Yeah.
So the key here is how, if you leave behind a very small strip which is going to get stretched or pulled or become sort of detached from its prevertebral blood supply, it's a better idea to remove that little strip of skin and do a complete pharyngeal reconstruction. Our choice would be usually a mucosal tube, which would either be a pull-up or a jejunum. Jejunum rarely, pull-up more frequently. But in some circumstances, we have even done a tubed PMMC or even an ALT flap. So if you have plastic surgeons working with you, then probably the range of options that you have will be wider. Otherwise, your PMMC is still a very good, strong workhorse.
Agree.
The cricopharyngeal stricture is more common with a tube pectoralis major flap, so that has to be taken care of while doing the reconstruction.
So what we usually do when we do a PMMC flap for such a defect, we also make a small triangle in the lower part of the flap. So when we are closing in the cricoid segment, cricopharyngeal segment will make a small triangle and feed in that extra triangle into that area. So that gives an extra mucosa and avoids a stricture formation there. And the rest of the steps are the same. Suture it properly, augment it properly, so that you do not have any pull and you do not have any leak. And then prep.
Yeah. So after the completion of the closure and closure of the incision, we must also insert the Romovac drains, which must charge to ensure that your neck flaps are well approximated. The postoperative care of the patients will consider comprise of humidification of the air, the routine tracheostoma and the TEP care, the drain output monitoring, and the nasogastric feeding is usually started on the second postoperative day. Do we have time for discussing complications? But I guess pharyngocutaneous fistula, which is the major complication, has been discussed. Is Dr. Poonam around? I think we are okay on time. So a word about pharyngocutaneous fistula, about the management. How would be the principles of management of pharyngocutaneous fistulas?
Thank you, Vidisha, for the nice presentation and lot of time. this thing. We have some couple of questions from the audience. So I think I will put up those questions for the expert panels to discuss. Arun?
Sudhir. Hi. How are you, Sudhir?
I'm fine. How are you?
So I think well, yeah.
Tough time there, I think. So,
same as.
And Elizabeth, nice
yes.
to meet you, madam.
Okay.
So,
I think, can you sum up, you know, the chat box and there are any questions for us?
Yeah, so there are a couple of questions which I have summed up. Two, three mm-hmm. questions our postgraduate students want to ask. Mm-hmm. So, one of them is, when will you do a role of pharyngeal neurectomy? Is there any role of pharyngeal neurectomy?
Pharyngeal neurectomy, I haven't done that yet, Sudhir. So anyone else can take that question.
Yeah, I do routinely, along with the cricopharyngeal myotomy, I do this pharyngeal neurectomy. Just with a bipolar diathermy, we used to cauterize that area of the pharyngeal nerve plexus. So along with the myotomy, this can also be done to prevent the spasm.
Yeah, so probably, but you know, sometimes too much this thing can cause hypotonic or hypertonic.
Yeah.
Hypertonic pharyngeal-esophageal segment. So in such a situation, is there any way for a TEP reconstruction? Suppose patient being posted for a secondary TEP and having a, so do you have any this thing?
I don't find any incidence of a hypotonicity if you do a pharyngeal neurectomy also. In fact, it gives more spasmless cricopharyngeal area for your TEP. So no harm in doing a pharyngeal neurectomy. We don't see any of this hypotonicity. In fact, cricopharyngeal myotomy should be done along with all laryngectomy for a TEP, but no harm in doing a pharyngeal neurectomy also if you anticipate some spasm in the cricopharyngeal area.
And so Vidisha, you also kindly discuss how will you advise for a TEP prosthesis care post-operatively?
For the TEP prosthesis yeah. care, sir, yes. we need to explain the patient that the prosthesis position has to be maintained in the 6 o'clock position, the pointing part of the silicon tube, so that the valve which is there, the roof of the valve is there in the 12 o'clock position and it avoids the leakage through the prosthesis. We have to explain the patient that the TEP needs to be cleaned after every meal specifically to avoid the blockage of the magnetic valve which is there in the central part of the TEP. The use of the brush that comes along with the TEP prosthesis needs to be well demonstrated to the patient. Also, we instruct the patient to apply antifungal solution such as clotrimazole over the prosthesis using a earbud sometimes, because the fungal colonization of the TE prosthesis is a very common thing. And for this purpose, also few people recommend a probiotic diet such as inclusion of curds and buttermilk in the diet of the patient to prevent the bacterial and the fungal colonization of the TE prosthesis. And the patient needs to be instructed that he has to report to the physician if he has any problem such as sudden stoppage of voicing, which could be due to dislodgement of the prosthesis or a blockage, or if he has a leak either from the central or a peripheral part of the prosthesis, which may need replacement or addressing the issue.
Great. So any difference between Provox or Bloomsinger, or any, you have any personal preference? Arun?
Sudhir, see, putting in a TEP is very glamorous. It looks nice. Initially, it works. The problem is when it fails. And so you have to sort of counsel the patient very well for recurrent costs before we put in a TEP. Because if it does leak, and usually peri-TEP leaks are quite challenging to manage. You can put in washers, you can put in purse strings like Franz Hilger's. You know, that is, he suggested the washer. And the submucosal spur string by Van der Poorten. You can do all that. But in spite of all that, if a leak persists, it's a very difficult situation to handle. And many centers, like tertiary centers like us, it's very nice to put in a tube. And nobody in the periphery, any ENT surgeon worth his salt, is not going to touch the patient. He will have to make that trip to you if a leak happens. So we counsel our patients very well. And I would tell him that it's like the cost of a scooter. If you're ready to shell out the cost of a scooter every 6 months, come get a TEP done. Otherwise, our choice would be still be. I agree it's not the right thing to do, but if you look at perspective, we would still give in an electrolarynx for these people. And what was your question? What if, Sudhir, one second, can you?
I think that was any advantage of these specific TEPs. I think you may have answered.
I would still go for a standard Provox one, which is, I think, because of market pressure, probably, you know, personal experience that they are very sturdy, hardy processes. You know, the one which lasts, my choice would be a Provox. Actually, the technique is the same in both. The way it works, the technology is the same. It has got a flap, a flange, which allows, you know, it's like a flap valve. So there is no difference in the technology of any of these valves which have come out. It's the quality of the build or the material, which I find Provox is probably better. The other ones, the duckbill ones, are all gone out of fashion. I don't use them anymore.
So another thing, sir, one question is, will you perform a primary TEP in a circumferential defect of the pharynx? Or will you always wait for healing and go for a secondary TEP? Or depends upon the situation. Or advise a electrolarynx for that patient. So what is your take on that?
So there is no hesitation in putting a TEP even if you have done a jejunum or a PMMC patch. But I would usually wait for everything to heal down. He goes home and comes back for a secondary TEP.
I think Vidisha was also mentioning that the voice quality may be affected.
So
depends upon the reconstruction.
Yeah, I would say the site of the party wall should be also taken into account. May not be an issue while you are considering a jejunum, because your pharyngeal cut is at a higher level. The party wall is probably not disturbed, but definitely not advisable in a gastric pull-up where you have dissected the party wall extensively.
Yeah, and wait till the edema subsides well after radiation. If you don't, then be in a hurry to put one. Because after radiotherapy, this mucosal flaps, they do swell up quite a bit. So, you know, and again, if when they eventually heal and the edema goes down, there will be a lot of pistoning if you put in a ward. So I would wait sufficiently long when I put in TEPs over mucosal.
In all cases of reconstruction, it's better to do it as a secondary TEP if at all you want. And as Arun said, the recurring cost and the recurrent leak, you have to motivate the patient to actually to face all these challenges, because it's almost around 40,000 for a prosthesis nowadays. So maybe in a 6-monthly or an yearly change of prosthesis will be really difficult for our set of patients. And another thing I found is some patients use routinely the HME filters over the tracheostoma after putting this TEP. That will always protect your prosthesis more. Like as Vidisha said, frequent cleaning with an antifungal and taking curd and buttermilk, all these can prevent your fungal infection and the periprosthetic leak and all. But some patients, I personally have experienced that patients with using HME along with the TEP over the stoma have a good life for the prosthesis and less leak rate.
So another question was is about the stricture formation postoperatively.
Yes.
And we said primary closure associated with higher stricture formation, or type of primary closure is associated with higher stricture formation. So what are your comments? Elizabeth, any comment on that?
Yeah. As we have already discussed, tension-free suturing is always better to prevent the stricture. So one thing is, if you don't have adequate mucosa at the cricopharyngeal area, that is a cause of stricture. Second thing is, if you put a total laryngopharyngectomy and you put a tube pectoralis major flap, that is more chance of stricture. And also the vertical closure compared to your horizontal one have more chance of stricture. As I said earlier, the stricture is more for a stapler closure. And also if there is a pharyngocutaneous fistula and the closure of the healing of the pharyngocutaneous fistula have an increased rate of stricture. So what we see is actually in a hypopharyngeal lesion, in a partial pharyngectomy cases, when you do a patch PMMC or even after a primary closure after a partial pharyngectomy, there is a more chance for stricture. And in such cases, we need to go for a serial dilatation when you follow up such cases. When they come with a starting of, in the initial onset of dysphagia itself, we usually go for an ogidioscopy and balloon dilatation routinely. So in such cases, I usually ask them to come every 3 months or 6 months to go for a balloon dilatation. And if it's needed, we take them up for a general anesthesia, and then rigid boogie dilatation also we used to do.
So Sudhir, one key issue is a patient doing well on a TEP for a long time develops a leak. Always exclude either a stricture or a local recurrence.
Okay.
Invariably there would be one.
So another thing is in a salvage laryngectomy, will you do an on-lay PMMC? What, Arun, will you do an on-lay
PMMC? Very interesting. So there are three surgeons in our group, two does, one does not do. And I think the literature reflects that, Sudhir. I think we have interposition flaps, the use of free flaps. So, Paleri, I think Prathamesh just referred to one of his studies in which it said that even if it does not reduce the leak, it decreases the duration of the leak. So in that way, it may be beneficial.
I think we are also doing one RCT, it is undergoing, so I don't know the final outcome of that. One more question, one last question. When will you start oral feeds in a salvage laryngectomy as well as in a primary laryngectomy? Asim and Arun, you can tell, then I'll ask.
Okay, so I don't have any evidence to quote for a salvage laryngectomy, but I think there has been an RCT done on this, not a very brilliant RCT. This is from, his name is Seven, S-E-V-E-N, very easy to remember, just Google him out. So just 65 patients, and he found one group all had TEPs, and they started feeding on the first post-op day in half the patients, around 30. And for other half, they only started it after 10 days. And they found that the rates of leak in hospitals stay were exactly the same. Now, these were not salvage patients. These were primary patients. But the house is still open. If you take it as a personal preference, I would wait out those 10 days and, feel happy that it has healed well before I would start.
Asim, do you have any difference of opinion? Asim?
In a per prime setting, I usually start after the second week. So in the second week only, we'll start the oral feeds. And in salvage setting, in 2 to 3 weeks. So another, I'll add on a week before starting feeds. In salvage setting, what I'd add is doing a video fluoroscopy before going in for starting oral feeds.
Elizabeth, any... Madam?
We don't usually do it as a generalized this thing, because we usually individualize according to different patient. If you anticipate, like in a badly radiated neck in a salvage surgery, if you anticipate a leak, maybe we can wait for 10 to 14 days. So we usually for a salvage laryngectomy, I usually wait for 7 to 10 days to start an oral fluid. And in a primary laryngectomy, I can start it by around 5 days. But even in cases, we have started at second day also, but it's very rare. So you have to actually individualize according to different patient. Generally, it is around 10 to 14 days after salvage and around 5 to 7 days after primary laryngectomy.
I think it is interesting. I think there is no hard and fast rule, but the experience do matter. And that is what we understand from the discussion. And but I think, as mentioned, most salvage, delayed leak can be a problem in salvage laryngectomy, so probably that is. So I'll hand over to our organizing team.